So I think that there are aspects of non-propositional cognition that can only be accessed dialogically, imaginally, not imaginatively, but imaginally. And I think that that is what prayer does for me. It gives me a dialogically enacted imaginal that allows me to simultaneously and in a coordinated fashion access deep parts of the psyche and open myself up to deep disclosure from reality. But that is not praying to a traditional theistic God.
Like a deity.
Not a deity as a super substance, yes.
What about supernatural?
What do I think that there is such a thing as the supernatural?
In the same way that we can say there's the physical, and then some people are willing to say there's something non-physical, some people say there's natural.
Yes.
Is natural all there is?
So if you give me what I argued for in that talk, extended naturalism, not only what is derivable from our natural sciences, but what must be presupposed by them, and we've been talking about, if you give me extended naturalism, and if you give me that our knowing isn't fundamentally propositional representational, but a conformity kind of knowing, I give a lot of arguments for why that's the case in that talk as well, making use of Catherine Pickstock and other people like that, then there's also a possibility of genuine, what I call strong transcendence, namely, there are real levels to reality. I can genuinely conform to them, so I can transcend myself in a way that's not just psychological. It has real epistemological and ontological consequences. So if you give me an extended naturalism that affords transcendence and therefore has a proper place for kind of experiences that people have when they have mystical experiences and other things like that, yeah, then there's nothing beyond the natural. But if you mean standard naturalism, which is just what's derivable from our physics, I think that's, well, I've already argued that's a performative contradiction. So I don't believe in that.
How do you know there's nothing beyond extended naturalism?
I don't know it in the same way that I know that Africa is a continent, because it's, I mean, again, I want to avoid a performative contradiction of saying I know something, I can know that there's something beyond what I can possibly know. So is your question more like, is there a way of knowing that is non-naturalistic? Would you accept that as a reformulation of your question?
Sure.
I don't know what that means without invoking some deep Cartesian dualism, and I think that is an absolutely philosophically bankrupt position. So insofar as supernaturalism, and I think there is a direct, but I wanted to do this Socratically with you, I think there's a deep interweaving between supernaturalism and a Cartesian dualism, and I think Cartesian dualism is absolutely bankrupt. That is why I do not think the supernatural is a viable category.
Does supernaturalism necessarily lead to Cartesian dualism?
It seems to require that if there's this reality that is in some sense able to enter into...
And by the way, for people who are watching, when I'm saying supernaturalism, I'm not arguing for ghosts. I'm not arguing for the paranormal. I'm just saying supernaturalism in the same way we're saying non-physical. I could also be saying non-extended naturalism because... John Vervaeke has his asterisk on naturalism, and I'll put a lecture on screen. It's the same lecture from before and in the lecture notes.
Excellent, excellent. And I thank you for doing that. I wasn't presupposing you were just...
I know that you would know what I'm referring to, but if someone just skipped forward and they hear us talking about supernatural, so we can say non-natural, it doesn't matter, a-natural, whatever
right.
prefix we want to give it.
So the idea is... it's somehow knowable or at least communicable to me. And so that means I can enter into relationship with it. And that, but how do my purely natural cognitive processes enter into this causal relationship? Well, they must have some non-natural capacity to enter into relationship with this non-natural reality. And that gets you into a kind of dualism, because what you're saying is there's an aspect of the mind that is does not share any of the properties or powers of everything else that we know about the mind in terms of our scientific endeavors, which sounds like a dualism to me.
Well, a dualism is different than Cartesian dualism.
I think it's Cartesian dualism in that I think Descartes ultimately thought that the what he called the soul was fundamentally immaterial and non-extended. And since that was sort of the sufficient conditions for physical reality, it was a non-physical thing for him. Yes. Non-natural.
So often when I'm speaking to people or when I hear different people's commenting on other people's theories, they'll bottom out at, I'll say, okay, to Jonathan Peugeot, do you believe God doesn't exist? Like, does God not exist? Can you, he would say, I don't even know what that means. People will say, the intellectuals tend to say that as a triumphant statement. Like, I don't even know what that means. Checkmate. And I say that when I say, I don't know what that means, I tend to say it tentatively, like I need to do my homework. So when someone says, I don't even know what it means, it doesn't fit my framework, I don't know what Cartesian dualism means, to me, I'm like, figure it out. Get yourself to the point where it makes sense.
Sure. And so I typically will, I will reserve, I don't know that what that means when I think there's a propositional or a performative contradiction, because that means I can't make sense of it. And I don't see how in principle you can. But if it's what you're talking about, where I don't know what that means, I'll frequently ask instead, well, what do you mean by? And that's what I frequently do. I'll say, well, what do you mean by this? Do you mean this? Do you mean that? I don't like the I don't know what that means.
You notice that as well?
I've noticed that. And
I don't mean to, John Peugeot, I've just said your name so many times because the audiences overlap and it's the easiest reference.
And he's a close friend and I value him.
That's not what he said to me off air, by the way.
Yeah, I don't like that move. I think it equivocates between two separate things. One is I'm accusing somebody in the philosophical sense that there's a propositional or a performative contradiction and that has to be resolved by them. And I've done that a few times with you and I think I'll stand by it. Or I don't know what it means. And then we should be doing exactly what you said. Well, we should unpack it. And what it does is it hangs between those two.
Right.
And I don't think people should equivocate to be give you a really clear, crisp answer. I don't think people should equivocate when they're being asked honest questions.
Okay, many times when people reason, they think they're reasoning forward from some axioms and then they just apply some rules of deduction. And then that's how I got to my conclusion.
Yeah.
But often what happens is they have something that they're afraid of letting go, like frightened of letting go. And something may lead to that. So they reject this something.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
What do you hold with such value that the cost of letting it go would be too much?
The reality is intelligible. A horror, which is not fear or terror, which is terror is the startle and puncture. I'm going to be biologically put out of order, right? And so a lot of horror movies aren't horror. They're just terror movies. There's a pun here. They're preying on our fear of predation, right? And I find those movies boring, by the way. Horror is when you get that aesthetic sense that I'm totally involved in this, but I don't know what's going on. And you're, it's more of like you feel your sanity sort of like.
Oh, yeah.
Right? And so horror is the sense that reality might ultimately not be intelligible. And I find that proposal horrific. And I trust, so what an odd sentence I'm about to utter. I trust my horror. I trust my horror in telling me, no, that is horrifying. And that I should do my best to challenge it.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.